Hi, my name is Pete Palumbo, and you're listening to U.S. Modernist Radio.
Mama don't allow no architecture around here. Mama don't allow no architecture around here. Oh, I don't care what mama don't allow, gonna draw mine modern anyhow. Mama don't allow no architecture around here.
Welcome to U.S. Modernist Radio, where we talk and laugh with people who enjoy, own, create, dream about, preserve, love, and hate modernist architecture, the most exciting and controversial buildings in the world. I'm Tom Guild. Sometimes even the best design needs a little help, particularly when Mother Nature is having a bad day. Her earthquakes, for example, do not care whether your building is modernist. Her monsoons are not impressed with how famous the architect was, even if he was Paul R. Williams. One of California's most well-known architects, Paul R. Williams' buildings get more famous year by year. There are two Paul R. Williams buildings in Los Angeles at UCLA that have been recently restored and shored up for such ominous natural events. And joining us today is the architect for those university projects, Scott Kelsey of CO Architects. After that, we'll enjoy some jazz with musical guest John Armato. And now, your host, always ready to shake, rattle, and roll the martinis, Mr. Modernism, George Smart.
Hey, thanks, Tom. Once you hear the story of Paul Williams, you can't help but be fascinated. I mean, there ought to be a movie. Williams was the first black architect to become a member of the AIA in 1923, and he was the first to become a fellow of the AIA, kind of like their Jedi Knights, in 1957. He's best known for his houses around Los Angeles, which we've documented at usmodernist.org/pwilliams. He did so many, and so many for celebrities, that he was referred to as the architect to the stars. He also did projects like the 28th Street YMCA, the first AME Church, Saks Fifth Avenue, Shrine Auditorium, and parts of the Beverly Hills Hotel. Williams is also famous, inaccurately, as the architect of the space-age theme building at LAX Airport.
You know, it looks like a flying saucer?
Yeah. It was actually designed by Jin Wong of Luckman and Pereira, but the famous photo of Williams in front of the building by Julia Shulman cemented this urban myth. Williams succeeded in a white-dominated profession in terms of both other architects and almost all his clients. Said his granddaughter Karen, he taught himself to draw upside down so white clients wouldn't be uncomfortable sitting next to him. It became one of the things he was known for. By law, he could not even live in some of the places where he designed houses, particularly in Flint Ridge, where deeds at the time said a black person could not even spend the night. As I said earlier, there really ought to be a movie, and there is. Past podcast guest Royal Kennedy Rogers spoke in our show 184 about her documentary Hollywood's Architect, The Paul R. Williams Story, which you can see for free on YouTube. U.S. Modernist Radio is underwritten by Diane Bald and the Budman family, restoring significant architecture in Toronto, Los Angeles, Malibu, and Palm Springs, and by modernist realtor Angela Roll.
In our ongoing mythology, modernist realtor Angela Roll dated Harry Potter at the age of 17 while she attended Le Corbusier High School just down the road from Hogwarts. They never played each other in soccer, but their proms were legendary, particularly the year they did Stairway to Heaven. Although ridiculed by architecture students for dating a magician, she learned how to conjure up the slightly tipsy ghost of Mies van der Rohe and aced all the exams. She even became class valedictorian. Now she's one of the few real estate agents with formal architecture training, giving practical advice to buyers and sellers. Plus, she knows what wizards like to eat. Angela Roll is your magic spell for modernism. Reach her at angelaroll.com. That's R-O-E-H-L, or call 919-995-0550. And George, before we get on to today's guest, I got one more bit on earthquakes.
Okay.
Charles Richter, you may know him as the inventor of the Richter scale for measuring earthquakes, had a Richard Neutra-designed house.
Really?
The 1937 home on 1820 Kenneth Way in Pasadena, designed with Peter Pfisterer, was 1,245 square feet and earthquake-proof. Sadly, Neutra could not design against seizure. The house was condemned by the state of California and destroyed in 1973,
to make way for the 210 foothill freeway. You can see photos of it at usmodernist.org/neutrip.
Thanks, Tom. Scott Kelsey, FAIA, is principal at CO Architects, a Los Angeles cross-disciplinary firm who was awarded the 2014 AIA California Firm of the Year Award. Specializing in research, teaching, healthcare, and civic facilities, Scott is nationally recognized for his expertise in the New American Medical School, having helped develop and implement new models for health sciences. His firm has also spearheaded the modernization of several historical buildings in L.A., including El Segundo High School and the 1913 building of the Natural History Museum of L.A. County. Welcome, Scott.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Nice to meet you both.
So, Scott, before we get started, our archivist discovered in the Valley News, December 1964, that you were part of an elite group at Encino Elementary School. What was it like being a part of the famous Cub Scout Pack 131?
Oh, my goodness. That is quite an archivist. Well, I have very fond memories of being a member of that Cub Scout Pack, and Encino Elementary School always holds an important place in my heart, as well as many of my friends that I still have today.
So why did they make the papers?
That I cannot tell you. I don't know, but it was quite a good Cub Scout group. However, having said that, I did not go into the Boy Scouts, so maybe that's my own personal failing.
You washed out of Cub Scouts?
I did.
Yeah, well.
I did. I couldn't cut the mustard.
I'm in that club,
yeah.
Too.
Yeah, I was thrown out of Weblos. There was a scandal we've talked about in previous shows.
Because I think it's Weblos.
Is it Weblos?
It is Weblos.
So.
Weblos.
See? That's why you were thrown out.
That's why I can't even say it correctly.
Exactly.
And your uncle was modernist architect John Kelsey, who was a partner with Thornton Ladd.
That's exactly right. Ladd and Kelsey. John was a wonderful influence on me, really led me into architecture. And I had the joy of being able to work with John. We worked for about a year together on two or three houses when he moved up north of Los Angeles. Yeah.
How old were you when you discovered that the house he lived in was special?
That would be at about the age of 15.
Okay.
So very early on, I became very focused on wanting to be an architect. And I remember being in that house in Pasadena. It's quite a beautiful house, sort of an H-shape modernist pavilion with a sort of pool in the middle of the H with all of the rooms opening to the outside. And really a lovely house. I remember what an influence it had on me.
He had it for a long time. And I understand it's still standing and in good condition.
It is. The house has just been recently renovated by a very good homeowner who is very sensitive to John's work and restored it quite beautifully.
How did you and John work together when you did? Was that after school or during high school or when was that?
I actually worked with John in my fourth year of architecture school as a summer position and then started working after I graduated from the University of Oregon and moved to San Francisco and worked there for a couple of years, two, 3 years. And then at John's invitation, I moved down to Santa Barbara. And at that time, he was working on residential projects and doing sculpture. And so he and I worked together for about a year in a studio, which was a wonderful learning experience for me.
Did that cause you to want to have your own modernist house?
It's made me want to have my own modernist house, but I've not quite gotten there yet. Maybe a little bit later, but it certainly is a great dream. And like many architects, we all dream of wanting to have our modernist house.
Is this like the cobbler in the shoes?
Yeah, it's the shoemaker's children have no shoes, Tom.
Right.
That's exactly right.
You should try them out. I hear they're all the rage.
They are.
Yeah, it's going to be good. Now, you spent a year in Denmark studying architecture at the University of Copenhagen, which is a wonderful experience. I just want to know, I've been to Denmark as well, but I just don't quite get, why did the Danes become so good at recognizing modern design, not just in architecture, but in art and sculpture and even down to things like tableware?
Yeah, it's an interesting question. I mean, my experience in being in Denmark, which then was a country of, I think, 5 or 6 million people, really gave me an appreciation for how much the Danes really believed in design and modernist design. They had some very, very influential architects in the 50s and 60s, like Arne Jacobsen. And I think that culture and society put a really big emphasis on complete design, which was really the design of the building, the interiors, the graphics, the hardware, the pottery, everything. And so it was something that they really believed very strongly in. And I think housing has always been of great interest to the Danish architectural community.
Did you bring back anything that's kind of become part of your signature style from that experience?
I think that what I took away from that experience was a real appreciation for total design, that everything that you work on in practice really has design associated with it, whether it's working on details, whether it's how you write notes, any of those things.
Did you follow down the path like Frank Lloyd Wright and start designing furniture for your projects?
You know, we have designed, I would say, parts of public spaces where we're able to really integrate furniture design into the space. It's always something that we really endeavor to do, as well as things like environmental graphics and how we think about lighting and color and finish. So we continue to push for that in our practice.
I always love in buildings when you come into the entranceway generally, and there's built-in seating into the walls.
Mm-hmm.
And you can tell that someone put a lot of care in trying to make this a welcoming space, but also a place of rest that you could be if you were waiting for somebody, or perhaps you just needed time to catch your breath, things like that.
Right. Yeah, I think that's exactly right. And I think what we've increasingly learned is that engagement and serendipity and communication and the sort of chance ideas, a lot of that takes place outside of formal learning environments. And they take place in those places that you come to in and around those kinds of more formalized spaces, offices or classrooms or seminar rooms or laboratories. And so for us, we're always searching for those places in our buildings that we work on.
And it seems to be, Scott, you know, kind of hit or miss. I remember when I went to graduate school, it was in a brand new building at Duke.
Mm-hmm.
And they had built these areas that were obviously intentional design features, like they had this circular couch
mm-hmm.
at the bottom of the stairwell that was supposed to be obviously some kind of conversation pit, where in theory, graduate students would get together and talk about very meaningful things.
So were the seats facing inward? Or
yeah, it was a circle, and the couch was like one.
How did you have to make a leap? To get
no, there was a little entrance section cut out.
Okay.
You could get into it.
Right.
There's no leaping involved.
Okay.
But still, no one ever sat in this conversation pit.
Oh, I see.
It was completely ignored. So I guess I'm getting to the question is, how do you design things that people are going to use, or is it kind of a crapshoot?
Well, I think we'd like to think it's not a crapshoot. I think we like to spend time thinking about what works. In other words, go back to buildings that we've worked on where we've tried to develop those ideas and ask ourselves and ask the students and the faculty and the staff, you know, does this work for you? And why does it work if it does? And why doesn't it work if it doesn't? And sort of bring those ideas forward. And I guess the other comment I would make is that we like to talk to students a lot. You know, so we learn a lot from talking to students, how they like to work, you know, how they engage with spaces, how they study in them, how they are casual in them. Because, you know, sometimes architects have a tendency to not think broadly, and they just sort of over-design spaces, and they create spaces such as what you just described. People don't like being in them.
Now, Scott, your career has focused on health sciences, particularly schools of medicine.
Mm-hmm.
And you're recognized as an expert in something called the New American Medical School. I guess my first question is, how's that different from the old American Medical School, you know, where they work the residents a lot without sleep?
And the nurses all wear a hose.
Yeah. Tell, what's different about this newfangled thing that you know a lot about?
Right. We call it the New American Medical School because, you know, over the last, call it 15, 18 years, there's been a big push to move forward and develop new medical schools around the United States, as well as increase the size of existing medical schools, in part because there's been a mandate to train more physician and health science providers. So that's one issue. And so that's created this big push in new space. The other issue is that there's been a big change in curriculum, how you teach these students, what kind of technologies they use. You know, in a sense, how do you teach medical students to learn how to work with patients more effectively early, as early in their teaching sort of model as possible? And so the new American Medical School is this idea that we're really creating a new building type that's really reflecting all of these mandates, all these curricular changes, all of the impetus that we're seeing in the medical industry. And so that's what we've really been focused on doing.
I noticed as a consumer of some of these services that when you walk into something like a hospital now, it's much friendlier. I mean, they're everything is starting to look like a mall. Like our airports have become malls, and you know, our hospital entrances have a Starbucks, and there's a Cinnabon, and there's a gift shop. I mean, there's this sort of retailization, which in some ways is a very good thing because it makes it a more positive experience of visiting the building.
Right. Yeah, I think what we've learned in our practice focuses on healthcare, you know, hospitals, medical office buildings, ambulatory care facilities. I think what the evidence shows is that the more welcoming and humane the treatment environment, the clinical environment is, the better the outcomes are for the patients. And better outcomes for patients is better for everybody, including the healthcare system, the insurance companies, and the patient, ultimately the patient themselves. And so you're seeing a big change in sort of moving to more hospitality environments, more welcoming, warm, friendly, open, sort of filled with natural light, connection to nature. These are all themes that we work on in healthcare. And in turn, these are also thematic ideas that we're working on in some of our medical school work as well.
So in medical schools or in hospitals, Scott, are they also moving to providing better experiences for visitors, like parents and spouses and kids of the people that are being cared for? I know that abroad, where there's lots of medical tourism, they'll build a 14-story hospital tower, and three of the floors will be guest rooms for the people that accompany the patients.
That's right. That's right.
There's a hospital in Raleigh that does that. Wake Med.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. I have a friend who, his wife was in the hospital for open heart surgery, and things went, well, she's fine, but it took longer than they thought. And he wound up staying there. He said, yeah, it's like a sort of like a Hampton Inn, kind of, in a room that was adjacent to hers. I mean, not same floor, but, you know, in the hospital, so it was easier to visit her. And I'd never heard of that before.
We see the same thing, which is that increasingly the family, the family caregivers, the partner, the spouse, they're part of the care journey of the patient. And so to the extent that they can be more integrated into the patient's care and can actually be on site and be part of the care team, it actually creates better outcomes. So that's what you're seeing when you see these buildings that have housing in them. I mean, what we've seen in California is the ability to create sort of sleeping areas in the room itself, so that where, you know, heretofore you'd bring out a cot or something like that.
Now one of those really painful chairs.
Oh, yeah.
Those lazy boy chairs.
Exactly. So no. So we're seeing more and more of that. So that's exactly right. All of your points are right.
Now, most buildings across America are not very well prepared for earthquakes, although in California since 1990 has been better than most at requiring certain safety features. What are the typical shortcomings of a post-World War II building?
Well, so it's important when you think about seismic safety, what it's important to understand, and certainly something we have understood over time, is that the standards and requirements for seismic safety continue to evolve as engineers learn more and as each, you know, major earthquake presents itself. And so what were seismic safety standards in the 50s and the 60s and the 70s are not emblematic of what they are now, because we've learned more. Buildings have to resist earthquakes in a more dynamic way. So it's an ongoing evolution, I think, is the first comment that I would make. The second is that buildings of the generation of Paul Williams, the two projects that we worked on at UCLA, they were both sort of late 50s, early 60s buildings. And I think they did not fully recognize the dynamic nature of earthquakes in terms of sort of the twisting that would occur. And so often they did not succeed well when the building would sort of move in a very dynamic two-directional way. And so they would often find failure when we would analyze these kinds of buildings.
Tell us about the two Paul Williams buildings at UCLA. Where are they on campus, and in what condition did you find them?
So the first project we worked on was the psychology department. It was originally called Franz Hall, and it was in a pretty central part of the campus, down near the Court of the Sciences, in the main portion of the UCLA campus. It is actually a three-building complex. It was built in 1967, about 80,000 square feet. So that was the first building that we worked on. And the Franz Hall building that subsequently was called Pritzker Hall, after a generous gift by the Pritzker family.
Known for their generous gifts, by the way.
Indeed they are. So that the reason why we were commissioned to undertake the project was really because of the seismic issues for Pritzker Hall. It was one of the last buildings on the catalog of buildings at UCLA that needed seismic upgrade. And so that was the original driver for the project, was really the seismic work. And everything that followed was really built upon the sort of necessity of the seismic upgrade. So that was the first project.
Now, let me ask you before we go on. So how do you go about this? Is this like, you know, those commercials for Ramjack where they come over to your house and send helical piers down to the bottom? I mean, how do you shore up a building like this?
Right. So good question. What we did in the case of that building is there had been quite a bit of analysis done of the building, and the original structural engineer who looked at the building really felt that the only way to solve it seismically was to create what we would call a sort of a brute force sort of stiffening of the building. The whole goal was to stiffen the building up because of the potential twisting and turning that would occur in a major earthquake. Our team came in, and our structural engineer came in looking at the building, its importance as a sort of historical building of Paul Williams, the need to try and reduce sort of all these application of shear walls around the building. We call them shear walls to resist twisting and turning. And we came in with sort of more of a tube arrangement, which was intended to be much more respectful of the building while meeting all of the seismic demands that were required.
So was this like an exoskeleton you built around it or what?
So what we were able to do was to really analyze the building dynamically, which is something that structural engineers have only been able to do in the last 10 years. So they actually take the building, build a complete three-dimensional model, and put it into simulation of an earthquake. And as a result, they were actually able to minimize or reduce the amount of sort of seismic intervention and really bring it in at the lower levels of the building with sort of diagonal tubes at the arcade levels on the first level. And then as it went up to the building, there was a sort of limited amount of what we would call shear walls or sort of concrete strengthening walls around the core. So the further the building went up, the lighter the structural impact was. So in a sense, we were strengthening the base of the building and allowing the tower to be more left alone.
Now, I've often heard that in order to earthquake-proof a building, it needs to be made a little bit more flexible so that it can sway instead of break. But is that a function of a newly constructed building, and this was different because it was existing?
Yeah, in the case of this building, it was an existing building, and the really driving issues for seismic safety were really about stiffening the building up. The building itself, if you looked at the building, it's a cube. It's 100 feet by 100 feet by 100 feet. It's a cube that sits on a base. And that base, which was an arcade around all four sides, was where the major challenges were because it was too light of a base and it wouldn't really respond well to the twisting of a major earthquake.
In addition to the seismic work, Scott, you also preserved their treasured fountain. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so in front of the building is what's referred to as the inverted fountain, meaning it's a fountain that actually drains down into a hole in the center. It's quite a famous fountain. It's also a rite of passage And so if you're a freshman at UCLA, one of the first things you do is you go over and you put your feet in the fountain. And when you graduate, that's one of the last things you do. So it is kind of a treasured, important fountain. And the building faces on to a major plaza, and this fountain really sits in the center of that plaza.
So what had to be done to fix that up?
It was more of a landscape gesture. We worked on all of the landscaping around the fountain. It was mostly in very good condition. I think what we were trying to do was to make sure that the whole ground floor of the Paul Williams building, which we call Pritzker Hall, we were trying to really open up the ground floor, make it more glazed so that it really has stronger connection looking into the fountain, and all the public spaces for the students had that view as well.
That's pretty cool. I'm looking at a photo of it now online.
Mm-hmm.
It says the inverted fountain is known for one famous Bruin tradition. I guess that's putting the feet in the fountain.
That's right. That's right. It's pretty cool.
Tell us about the Botany Building. That was the second project.
Yes. The Botany Building was built before Pritzker Hall. It was built in 1959. It's about 40,000 square feet, so about half the size of Pritzker. It essentially is a three-story building, and it was really designed, purpose designed for botany research and display, and it connects directly to what's called the Mildred Mathias Open Horticultural Garden Space. Our work there was similar to Pritzker. It was a wholesale rethinking of the interior to create more modern research laboratories and teaching laboratories, as well as a more modest upgrade of the building from a seismic point of view. It was not as significant as Pritzker Hall was, but we did address some seismic issues in the building as well. In the case of Botany, it was a complete energy upgrade, all new systems, and of course that was similar to our project for Pritzker as well.
How do you upgrade the energy systems in a building these days?
I mean, like the electric wiring, air conditioning?
Yeah, good question. So basically, the systems that were put into that building, those systems are 60 years old, so they're completely out of date. Mm-hmm. They're very energy inefficient, and so essentially we pulled out all of the mechanical, all of the electrical, all of the plumbing, and brought in really state-of-the-art systems, you know, systems that are very sustainable, systems that lowers energy utilization really significantly. So a complete wholesale system upgrade.
I've always wondered about this, Scott, is when you do a whole replacement about that in a typical university building that is generally lots of concrete. I mean, when they build the thing initially, all that plumbing and wiring is going right through the concrete. So how do you pull all that out?
Well, you do it carefully. Like, you do have to pull.
I was going to say with your hands.
Well, you do have to pull it all out. In some cases, we have to introduce much larger openings for, you know, the vertical shafts and things like that for air and water and electrical. And wherever we do that, then we have to seismically upgrade those openings if we change, you know, kind of the overall structure of the building.
Now, when you're working on both of these buildings, how do you make the judgment call between upgrading something that's more optional, an aesthetic element, not an HVAC, and preserving sort of the original intent of the architect, Paul Williams? How do you make that call?
Right. So I think the first principle that we follow, and we work with historical consultants to help us think through this. So we had a outside university consultant who worked with us, who really surveyed the building. They looked at all the sort of special historical fabrics. They designated the fabric at different tiers. And whatever decisions that we made about changing the shell of the building or adjusting the interior, we would always go back to the survey work that they did. In general, the approach is that anything on the outside of the building, we have to be very thoughtful about preserving existing and sensitive architectural fabric that he created, sort of architectural fabric, the exterior. Wherever we introduced sort of new architecture, the approach that you take is not to try and recreate the architecture of that period, but to create an architecture that's contrasting and therefore is respectful of the original. So that if you're looking at that building, you know what's new versus that which was existing, if that makes sense to you.
So give me an example of how that would show up.
Right. So what we did on the outside of the building, in the case of Pritzker Hall, going back to the first building we talked about, we wanted to create a two-story lobby at the ground floor. And so we made that lobby all glass. Now, what would be appropriate for the period of Pritzker in 1967 is you wouldn't introduce all glass there. It would be a different fenestration pattern. In this case, it was all glass, so that when you look at the building, you clearly can see this new glass wall inside the arcade, which clearly contrasts with the existing sort of architecture of the shell of the original Pritzker Hall. That's one example.
Okay.
In the case of the seismic braces, they're tubes, and you can see them if you look at an image of the building. You can clearly see that those tubes are very different from the original architecture of that period of time. So you know that this is a new intervention, but it's done in such a way that it respects the arcade of the building as you look at it.
And the building is safe to walk into because it's got reinforcement.
So it
should
does.
You be in there while the earthquake hits, you'll be okay.
You'll be safe.
Yeah.
That's right. That's the goal. So the building has been brought up to contemporary seismic standards. It's also been brought up to all UCLA standards with regard to energy efficiency, electrical use, low voltage lighting, that sort of thing. So it's a contemporary building now.
How long did it take to accomplish this? This is a lot of work.
Yeah, we worked on this project for, 5, 6, 7 years. We went through a whole programming round in a master planning process working with the university, and then we work very closely with the faculty because, remember, the psychology work that they were doing in 1967 is not the psychology work they're doing in 2020. And mm-hmm. So we had to redesign the entire interior of the building to reflect the teaching space, the research environments, how they work with patients. And so it's very contemporary sort of psychology, teaching, and learning space within the building. So completely rethought.
Scott, thank you so much for joining us. This has been very informative.
Good. I'm glad you're enjoying it. We love the project. We're very proud of it. And I think we feel very proud to be able to take these two really important buildings by Paul Williams and bring them up to contemporary standards.
Oh, and this just in, we have more research on Cub Scout Pack 131.
Oh,
evidently. This was quite the pack. I mean, they would have this thing called the Blue and Gold Dinner every year. I mean, this is kind of the top of the pack. Maybe they will have this again, Scott, and you can be one of the honorees.
I'd love to be invited.
At the Blue and Gold Dinner.
Maybe they'll have hot dogs.
Indeed.
Drummer John Armato grew up taking drum lessons at age 8, inspired by Buddy Rich, followed by a season with the Kansas City Youth Symphony and the rhythm sections of jazz educator Kirby Shaw at the University of Missouri, Kansas City. In 1986, he earned a coveted spot with the Disneyland All-American College Band, a 35-show-a-week gig for musicians from the country's top music schools. John has backed the Ink Spots, the Drifters, and the Platters, as well as the Jimmy Dorsey and Guy Lombardo orchestras. He appears on the albums Claudette by vocalist Claudette Stone, Comfort by praise singer Lisa Blecker, Hepcat's Holidays by Peter Petty, and many others. The Drummer Loves Ballads is John's first CD solo release.
That's a great title.
Yeah. And I want him to design the next iPhone because the CD package design is brilliant. It is beautifully printed and photographed, and includes instructions about making quite tasty 1950s cocktails while you were listening to the CD. Welcome, John.
Oh, my gosh. Thank you, George. I'm certainly glad to be with you.
Are those recipes from your personal collection?
Oh, they're not, but I'm not really a beer guy. I'm a little bit of a wine guy, but I like my cocktails. And I had a colleague custom design those specifically for this project.
Well, it's just really gorgeous, and I can't wait to share a martini with you at some point.
Well, we'll plan on it.
Now, as a kid, Buddy Rich, the drummer, was on The Tonight Show repeatedly with Johnny Carson, and
absolutely,
that was an influence for you. You asked your parents for a Buddy Rich album.
Well, I did, but I had a very particular request, and that was, I think, telling about what I was responding to in the music. And that is, I said, I want a Buddy Rich album, but not one where he's just playing solos. I want one with the rest of the band on it. Now, Buddy is widely considered, you know, one of the most extraordinary drummers in history. And he is, of course, one of the supreme soloists, was one of the supreme soloists. But it was the total musical ensemble that got me so excited. So, you know, what's funny is Buddy never recorded an album of just solos.
Oh, okay.
I was cautioning them against something that didn't exist. But, right. But I wanted them to be sure to give me an album of music. But yeah, Buddy was probably one of my very first albums.
I remember watching him on Carson, and he always had some new hobby he was doing. Like he had gotten into martial arts at one time.
Oh yeah. Yeah. No, he was prolific in that sort of thing. You know, he was in vaudeville from the age of three, and a lot of people don't realize that he was an accomplished tap dancer. He sang, but yeah, he was into fast cars. He studied martial arts. I think he was in the Marines and actually served as a judo instructor in the Marines at one time. So yeah, he was a complex and varied man.
Tell us, John, about your album, The Drummer Loves Ballads. What inspired you to put this together and to choose ballads as your main source of music?
Well, it began as sort of a moment of rejection, honestly, going back 41 years now. But it became an album of reflection on relationships and what's important in life. And I got really focused on doing this as just a passion project. I wanted to just put something I deemed beautiful into the world and let others decide if they think it's beautiful or not themselves. And for me, that meant trying to create something that was both fresh and familiar. You know, there's old advice for writers, you know, write the book that you want to read. Well, I wanted to record the album I wanted to listen to. And I love mood albums, and I wanted something for lazy afternoons or romantic evenings or melancholy midnights. And I wanted it to sort of fit on my shelf of albums next to other long-loved jazz favorites, and I wanted it to fit there for other listeners. And thanks to about 34, 35 amazing musicians and engineers, that's the album that we created.
One of the songs from John's album is Poinciana, which Cubans claim comes from a favorite Caribbean flower. But composer Nat Simon said the title came to him dining at Leon's in New York City. Simon said he jotted down a rough draft on his tablecloth and with Leon's blessing took the tablecloth home.
Huh.
According to Wikipedia, which knows everything, lyrics for this song were completed in about 30 minutes by Buddy Bernier, who cited as his inspiration a postcard of a royal poinciana tree he recently received. The song has been covered by band leaders Glenn Miller, Jerry Wald, Bing Crosby, Benny Carter, and David Rose, and it got famous in the 1952 film Dreamboat, and later, oddly enough, in 1995's Bridges of Madison County. Here's John with Poinciana.
I love the piano in that.
Oh, he's
drummer is great.
Yeah, that was fabulous, John.
Thank you so much. It's you know, there's a little bit of an interesting failure story behind this, which is the tune. Your recitation of the history is amazing and spot on. But the tune, it was especially made popular by a pianist named Ahmad Jamal, a very famous jazz piano player.
Yeah.
And his drummer was a guy by the name of Vernel Fournier, who came from New Orleans. So there's a classic sort of second line, sort of New Orleans slash Latin sort of rhythm that Vernel made famous playing on that tune. And when we went into the studio to do this, I had a take on that we were doing, and it just didn't go well. We weren't happy with it. And the next day in the studio, I don't really know why, I randomly said, let's try it again and let's try it as a shuffle. And it felt so much better. And that's the version we just heard. Mm-hmm. And for me, if I just close my eyes, it's like I'm just walking through a field of those poinciana trees and there's a breeze and all is right with the world. So it was fun to try a different twist on how that was performed.
Sounds a little like Palm Springs, doesn't it, Tom?
Yeah, it does.
Oh, a little breeze, yeah, yeah. When I was growing up, my parents, George and Ann, took me to a jazz nightclub that's long gone now called the Frog and Nightgown. Your parents, Frank and Millie, had a favorite jazz club in Kansas City.
Absolutely. It was called the Trocadero. And as I've done a little research on it and I've talked to people about it, it's become clear there were Trocaderos everywhere in the 50s. You know, there's the famous Trocadero that's in the movie Mank in L.A. that was a real swanky, you know, popular nightclub. And it was apparently fashionable for nightclubs to sort of invoke this exotic tropical locale in that era. But the Trocadero in Kansas City was a real small neighborhood sort of joint. And my parents started dating in 1955, and they would frequent that club. Unfortunately, they both passed away in the past couple of years. But until their dying days, literally, whenever they would hear a really sultry saxophone or very mellow slow dance ballad, whatever, they'd sort of lean in and say to me, you know, that's just the kind of music we used to hear at the Troc. And the Troc was their benchmark for beautiful, sort of the era, mid-century cocktail jazz. And I always just was sort of entertained by that. And when I was working on the album, my producer is just a very good friend of mine named John Cushon, who's a world-class drummer. He's married to Alita Adams, who's a very well-known singer who had some...
Oh, yes, we're hoping to have her on the show soon.
Oh, well, Alita is fabulous. And Alita and John have been dear friends of mine for a long time. I'm 58, and I spent my 21st birthday listening to Alita in a club in Kansas City, so that gives you some idea. But we sort of used their house as sort of headquarters for the Drummer Loves Ballads during the recording. And one night, Alita said, "Now you're gonna write an original for the album, aren't you? Because everything else is a cover." I said, "Well, Alita, I don't really write music." And she said, "You should. I think you can. You've got something to say." An extraordinary infusion of belief and confidence. And on the plane ride home, I started thinking, you know what? I should tell the story of the Troc. So that's the one original on the album. I wrote the lyrics, and the pianist on the album, Wayne Hawkins, who's a fabulous player and composer, wrote the music. And it tells the story of their romance at the Trocadero and how it became a point of reference for them throughout all these years.
This next song appeared in the 1995 movie Sabrina, and was written by John Williams and Alan and Marilyn Bergman. John Williams, who turns 80 this year, of course, wrote the Star Wars theme.
Oh, that John Williams.
And the Bergmans, who are royalty among songwriters and performers, penned many famous film songs like The Way We Were and You Don't Bring Me Flowers. Here's John and the song Moonlight, with vocalist Ron Gutierrez and the late, great Molly Hammer.
Shadows play when the thought of what could happen takes your breath away. Sighs and whispers, quiet laughter in the air, unspoken invitations everywhere. Relatively easy to be swept away in the half-light. Can we trust the way we feel? Can we be sure that anything is real?
Stars keep secrets as they wander into
we'll be there.
The website is thedrummerlovesballads.com. John, thanks for joining us. This has been such a pleasure.
Oh my gosh, my pleasure, I assure you. Real delight to spend time with you.
Thanks for listening. U.S. Modernist Radio is underwritten by Diane Bald and the Budman Family, restoring significant architecture in Toronto, Los Angeles, Malibu, and Palm Springs. And by Modernist Realtor Angela Roll. Okay, Tom, take us out.
Visit usmodernist.org's massive archives to listen to past shows, discover documentation of 15,000 significant modernist houses, and access 4 million pages of classic 20th century architecture magazines. U.S. Modernist Radio is produced by Soundtracks Recording Studios in Raleigh, North Carolina. Our theme song is performed by George Smart and Robinson Earl. Carrie Cesarino is off this week, so backup archivist Kelly Policelli donned the rogue archivist beret to tunnel deep into that blue and gold dinner and do some guest research. U.S. Modernist Radio is a production of Modernist Archive Incorporated, a nonprofit educational archive for the documentation, preservation, and promotion of modernist residential design. I'm Tom Guild. George and I will be back soon with more architectural tremors, more volcanic guests, and more modernist aftershocks in another seismic edition of U.S. Modernist Radio. I feel the earth move.